بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Thanks دكتور هيبة for introduction. Our agenda for today, chronic CKD nomenclature, secondary causes of dyslipidemia, CKD and dyslipidemia, hemodialysis versus peritoneal dialysis, lipid nephrotoxicity, dyslipidemia and diabetic kidney disease, National Kidney Foundation recommendations, management mainly KDIGO guidelines and other guidelines, and future therapeutics. Quick reminder of CKD nomenclature used by KDIGO, already presented by Dr. Hisham. Secondary causes of dyslipidemia, medical conditions, nephrotic syndrome, hypothyroidism, diabetes mellitus, excessive alcohol consumption, liver disease, many medications like anticonvulsant, highly active antiretroviral therapy, diuretics, beta blockers, androgens, oral contraceptives, corticosteroids, cyclosporine, and sirolimus. CKD is associated with dyslipidemia, including hypertriglyceridemia, elevated LDL cholesterol, and accumulation of apolipoprotein B containing lipoproteins and low HDL levels. CKD leads to down regulation of lipoprotein lipase and the LDL receptor, increased triglycerides in CKD due to delayed catabolism of triglyceride-rich lipoproteins with no differences in production rate. CKD is associated with lower levels of ApoB1 due to decreased hepatic excretion and the higher ApoB, ApoO1, decrease lecithin cholesterol acyl transferase and increase cholesterol ester transfer protein lead to increased VLDL normal or increased LDL and decreased HDL. Beyond decreased HDL cholesterol levels, HDL in CKD is less effective in its antioxidative and anti-inflammatory functions. As regard to lipid changes in renal diseases, dyslipidemia in CKD is characterized by HDL deficiency and dysfunction, decreased apolipoprotein A1 levels, increased VLDL, IDL, and the triglyceride levels, increased apolipoprotein C3 and C2 ratio to C2 ratio, normal to increased LDL levels, and increased oxidized LDL levels. As CKD progresses, the dyslipidemia often worsens. In an evaluation of 2001 to 2010 National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey in NHANES, the prevalence of dyslipidemia increased from 45.5 in CKD stage 1 to 67.8 in CKD stage 4. Similarly, the use of lipid-lowering drugs increased from 18% in CKD stage 1 to 44.7% in CKD stage 4. A study was done on 1,000 hemodialysis patients. They found that only 20% had normal lipid levels defined as LDL below 130 over milligram per deciliter, and HDL more than 40, and triglycerides less than 150 milligram per deciliter. Also on 317 peritoneal dialysis patients, only 15% had normal lipid levels. A larger study evaluating dyslipidemia in more than 21,000 incident dialysis patients found 28 prevalence of dyslipidemia and suggested a threshold of non-HDL cholesterol over 100 milligram per deciliter to identify dyslipidemia in CKD stage 5. Peritoneal dialysis versus hemodialysis. Peritoneal dialysis is associated with higher cholesterol levels than hemodialysis, although the reasons are not fully understood. In subjects who switched from peritoneal dialysis to hemodialysis, there was a drop in cholesterol levels of almost 20%. As regards to lipid nephrotoxicity, lipids can be deposited in the kidney, leading to some alterations that are included under the term lipid nephrotoxicity. High LDL cholesterol level and the oxidation of these particles are trapped by mesangial cells, promoting their proliferation and finally leading to glomerular sclerosis. Free fatty acids have demonstrated their ability to induce direct damage to the podocyte, especially in the presence of albuminuria. Additionally, saturated fatty acid can leach out, causing tubulointerstitial damage. All these renal toxic actions of different particles of lipid metabolism are increased when obesity is associated with dyslipidemia due to increased oxidative stress, inflammation, and overactivation of renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. Together, these alterations theoretically would have the ability to promote the development of progressive renal failure. However, the published clinical studies present conflicting results. On one hand, the association between incidence of CKD and alterations in lipid profile in general population has been proven in epidemiological studies. On the other hand, the predictive capacity of lipid profile to aggravate the progression of renal failure seems proven in association with obesity, but it is doubtful when analyzed independently. This figure shows the lipid changes in the effect of lipid nephrotoxicity on the kidneys. Glomerular injury, increased proteinuria, increased albumin uptake, increased podocyte injury, increased inflammatory cytokines, increased mesangial cell proliferation, altered insulin signaling, and tubular interstitial injury, increased proteinuria, increased inflammatory cytokines, increased immunoglobulins, which lead to progressive kidney disease. As regards dyslipidemia with diabetic kidney disease, dyslipidemia has been shown to play crucial roles in the development and the progression of diabetic nephropathy. Managing dyslipidemia and diabetic nephropathy is extremely important because patients with diabetic nephropathy are at high risk of cardiovascular disease associated death. Impaired lipoprotein metabolism, such as increase in VLDL and LDL, with decrease in HDL, is observed in patients with diabetes mellitus. In addition to these quantitative changes, also the quality changes, including small dense LDL and oxidized LDL, make lipoproteins more pro-atherogenic in diabetes. The prevalence of high LDL in patients with diabetes appears to be similar to that of the general population, as demonstrated by Framingham study and the United States National Health and Nutritional Examination Survey in NAHALS. The United Kingdom Prospective Diabetes Study, UKPDS, no difference in total cholesterol levels were reported between diabetic and non-diabetic subjects. The LDL levels were comparable in males but higher in females with type 2 diabetes compared to those without type 2 diabetes. On the other hand, increased serum level of triglyceride and decreased HDL were reported in diabetic patients in these studies. In Framingham study, elevation in serum levels of triglyceride was observed in 19% of males and 17% of females with type 2 diabetes, whereas it was observed only in 9% of males and 8% of females in non-diabetic subjects. New QBDS, 50% of patients with type 2 diabetes had high serum level of triglycerides. The heart protection study showed the prevalence of low HDL was higher in diabetic individuals, 21% in males and 25% in females compared to non-diabetic individuals, 12% in males and 10% in females. It has been recognized that lipid nephrotoxicity is involved in development of diabetic nephropathy since 1970. Previous studies have shown that dyslipidemia facilitates glomerulosclerosis under diabetic conditions. Dyslipidemia complicated with diabetes has been shown to be involved in the development of diabetic nephropathy. This figure illustrates these findings. Dyslipidemia with diabetic kidney disease, quantitative changes, increased VLDL, LDL, and IDL, decreased HDL, quality changes, oxidized LDL, and the glycated LDL, all lead to diabetic nephropathy, atherosclerosis, which will end to cardiovascular events and end-stage renal disease. Conclusion, in accordance with large body of evidence, supporting the acknowledgement that micro and microangiopathy are a continuum of the disease, diabetic kidney disease may also share some common risk factors with atherosclerosis, including dyslipidemia. Thus, atherogenic dyslipidemia, high triglyceride, and low HDL is an independent risk factor for development and the progression of diabetic kidney disease, being partly responsible for its residual risk once glucose and blood pressure control is achieved. National Kidney Foundation recommends routine screening of all adults and adolescents with CKD using a standard fasting lipid profile, total cholesterol, LDL, HDL, and triglycerides, and follows the classification of National Cholesterol Education Panel for levels desirable, borderline, or high. Management of dyslipidemia in CKD patients. First, we'll talk about dietary considerations. Essential dietary modification are initial step towards the management of dyslipidemia in CKD. Mediterranean diet has been extensively studied, providing evidence of ameliorated lipid profiles in CKD, as well as post-renal transplant. Moreover, the benefits of low protein diet on cholesterol levels and the renal function were recently reported in patients with advanced CKD. Also, a high fiber diet was also met with favorable outcomes in means of improved quality of life and lipid profile within 6 weeks of initiation. As regards our KDIGO clinical practice guideline for lipid management in CKD, In adults with newly identified CKD, including those treated with chronic dialysis or renal transplantation, we recommend the evaluation with a lipid profile, total cholesterol, LDL, HDL, and triglycerides. In adults with CKD, including those treated with chronic dialysis or kidney transplantation, follow-up measurement fluid level is not required for the majority of the patients, but not graded. Pharmacological cholesterol lowering treatment in adults. In adults aged equal or more than 50 years with GFR less than 60, but not treated with chronic dialysis or renal transplantation, we recommend treatment with a statin or statin ezetimibe combination. In adults, again, more than 50 years, but with CKD, GFR more than 60 milli per minute, we recommend treatment with a statin. In adults aged 18 to 49 years with CKD, but not treated with chronic dialysis or renal transplantation, we suggest statin treatment in people with one or more of the following: known coronary disease, diabetes mellitus, prior ischemic stroke, estimated 10-year incidence of coronary death or non-fatal myocardial infarction more than 10%. In adults with dialysis-dependent CKD, we suggest that statins or statin ezetimibe combination not be initiated. In patients already receiving statin or statin ezetimibe combination at the time of dialysis initiation, we suggest that these agents be continued. In adult renal transplant recipients, we suggest treatment with a statin. In adults with CKD, including those treated with chronic dialysis and kidney transplantation or kidney transplantation and hypertriglyceridemia, we suggest that therapeutic lifestyle changes be advised. As regard to the recommended doses of statins in adults with CKD, as regard to lovastatin, GFR, CKD stage 1 and 2, as in general population in all of them, but in lovastatin in CKD from 3A to till CKD stage 5, not studied, fluvastatin 80 milligram per day, atorvastatin 20, rosuvastatin 10, simvastatin ezetimibe 20 milligrams for simvastatin and 10 milligrams for ezetimibe, bravastatin 40 milligrams per day, simvastatin 40, and betavastatin 2 milligrams per day. Here, as regard to other guidelines, the European Society of Cardiology and the European Atherosclerosis Society in 2019. They said that the treatment objective is according depending to the cardiovascular risk. If the GFR from 30 to 55, the LDL reduction should be equal or more than 50%, and the LDL should be below 70 milligram per deciliter. If the risk is very high, GFR below 30, then the LDL should be below 55 milligram per deciliter. As regard to Spanish Society of Atherosclerosis by 2019, primary prevention in patients with CKD more than grade 3B, LDL should be below 130 milligram per deciliter. In secondary prevention, it should be below 70 milligram per deciliter. Here are other international guidelines. The American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association guidelines in 2018, non-dialysis dependent CKD indication, age 40 to 75 years with LDL between 70 and 190 milligram per deciliter plus 10 year ACV CD risk more than or equal 7.5. Here for Kidoki stage 3 to 5 CKD. As regard treatment, moderate intensity with statin plus or minus ezetimibe. As regard dialysis-dependent CKD for American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association, in LDL lowering therapy, continuation of statin and treatment naive statin initiation not recommended. As regard renal transplantation, there is no recommendation in American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association. As regard to European Society of Cardiology and European Association of Atherosclerosis in 2019, non-dialysis dependent CKD indication, Kidoki stage 3 to 5 CKD, and the treatment is by statin plus or minus ezetimibe. Dialysis dependent CKD, continuation of therapy, and treatment naive statin initiation not recommended. As regard to renal transplantation, statin plus or minus ezetimibe. As regard to Canadian Cardiovascular Society in 2016, non-dialysis dependent CKD indications, age equal or more than 50 years with GFR less than 60 milli, statin plus or minus is deemed strong twice as regards to dialysis dependent on LDL lowering therapy, continuation of therapy, conventional low, treatment naive statin initiation not recommended, and renal transplantation statin conditional moderate. Omega-3 fatty acids, omega-3 polyunsaturated fatty acid reduced triglyceride levels by 20 to 50 at optimal recommended dosages in vitro and in vivo experimental studies showing anti-inflammatory, antioxidative, as well as acylsclerotic plaque stabilizing activity. While omega-3 fatty acids suggest that these compounds may have cardiovascular and renal protective effects. However, the role in management of patients with CKD still remains unclear. Clinical trials have shown conflicting results, probably related to different doses, duration of therapy, sample size, study population, meta-analysis have been limited by the quality of available studies. As regard to the future therapeutics, first we'll talk about the proprotein convertase, subtilisin, hexin type 9 inhibitors. New data are now revealing that a considerable patient population failed to achieve lipid goals only on statins, and a significant percentage can tolerate treatment. Therefore, extensive work has recently been done in generating novel LDL-lowering agents that would act through mechanisms different from statins. Among others, monoclonal antibodies to BCSK9 seem particularly promising. BCSK9 monoclonal antibodies have shown to be well-tolerated and very effective at lowering LDL. The use of BCSK9 inhibitors has changed the clinical practice of dyslipidemia and their effects in cardiovascular events. Nowadays, two active principles have been commercialized, ivolumab and alirumab, with indication in patients with LDL over 100 milligram per deciliter, history of cardiovascular events, and the higher statin doses prescribed. Clinical trials with them have included CKD patients, although GFR has been limited to 20 only or higher. The published sub-analysis of them have demonstrated at least the same efficacy in reduction of LDL and cardiovascular events and safety in patients with CKD. However, as these drugs are very powerful in reducing LDL, some safety concerns appeared in the past. Once safety is proved, we conclude that BCSK9 inhibitors are beneficial for CKD patients. They act mainly by blocking the enzyme protein BCSK9 by means of monoclonal antibody, whose main function is to block the recycling of LDL receptors, and it will be illustrated by a figure. BCSK9 is a protein that binds to LDL cholesterol when it binds to hepatic LDL receptor. Together, this complex of BCSK9 and LDL cholesterol are taken into the hepatocyte attached to the LDL receptor. The presence of these protein with LDL receptors and LDL cholesterol marks the receptor for degradation, and the receptor degradations lead to increasing circulating LDL levels as the LDL receptor is not recycled back to the hepatocyte surface, where it will continue to bring LDL cholesterol into the liver and out of the plasma. When BCSK9 inhibitors, monoclonal antibodies are administered, the RLDL are internalized into the hepatocyte along with an LDL molecule. Once inside it, in the absence of the enzyme, they separate, so the LDL molecule is degraded again, and the LDL is recycled again and can return to the surface to continue capture LDL molecules. It will be simplified by the figure. Here's the LDL. Here, when it comes to the hepatocyte, this is the LDL receptor. Then it is attached to it and enters inside the hepatocyte. Then the enzyme BCSK9, if it's attached to this complex, it prevents that the LDL receptor go again and capture more LDL molecules. The enzyme is marked by green, but when the BCSK9 inhibitors, these are given, then they block this enzyme. So the LDL receptor can continue recycling to the surface and take more LDL molecules, so it will lead to decrease LDL lifts. Many clinical trials are now published and establish a number of important findings. First, these monoclonal antibodies are effective both as monotherapy as well as in addition to statin therapy. Second, they are optimally dosed subcutaneously every 2 weeks to maintain a constant reduction LDL component. Third, they achieve LDL reduction of 40 to 60% that are stable with chronic therapy. Fourth, while they have little effect on triglyceride-rich lipoproteins or HDL, they unexpectedly reduce plasma levels of lipoprotein A And fifth and last, they are generally safe and well tolerated, including by patients who have a history of difficulty tolerating statin therapy. Last slide. Rapidly, other potential therapeutic approach against dyslipidemia in the setting of CKD, PPAR agonists, PPAR alpha agonists, tilfibrates, they act by fatty acid, increase fatty acid oxidation, increase fatty acid uptake, and increase HDL. PPAR gamma agonists, thiazolidinediones or glitazones, bioglitazones, act by increased fatty acid oxidation and decrease triglycerides, decrease LDL and increase HDL. They found that they decrease major adverse cardiac and cerebrovascular events, and others like lipoprotein A inhibitors, but they are not studied in CKD populations. And last, gut microbiota modulation by taking chickpea, lawal hummus, yani green tea, or other components, but also they are not studied enough in CKD population. Thank you.